Good evening all. Thanks Dr. Manoj, thanks Dr. Unni for calling us. So I was given a topic of role of multimodal imaging in differentiating mimics. So this is my first case. The case is a known case of Eales disease, which presented to us for a routine checkup. As you can see, the laser marks are there. But on a routine checkup, we could identify, yes, he's having a little cataract more in the left eye, but there's some mass kind of a lesion which was there in the right eye, in the temporal quadrant, as we can see, which doesn't show any changes, but it's a mass lesion for unknown origin. So we did an autofluorescence. As we can see, autofluorescence does not show any stipple kind of an appearance or any specific or diagnostic kind of an appearance in this. So we thought of, okay, let's evaluate, because considering around 60 years of age, let's rule out melanoma, do an FFA, ICG to confirm what it is actually. So we did a B scan, but that was a little inconsistent. As you can see, it was showing probably an angle kappa. I'm not sure whether this would be a choroidal excavation, but the MRI was a little disaster for us, because the MRI was showing that probably it can be melanoma. So we told, okay, let's plan for an FA. But as we planned, we did an OCT. So that's what the multimodal imaging comes into play. As you can see, this is a scan for a melanoma, where you can see that all the layers of the retina are looking intact, and those are pushed up. But in this case, as you can see, there is a separation. There is a Bruch's membrane, and this is the probable RP, which is separated, and there is some kind of a mound over here which is having an aftershadowing. Along with that, the most important part is here, where you can see some kind of small PEDs and little subretinal fluid. This gave us an idea that probably this can be either a PEHCR or probably a PCV in the periphery which is causing this. So we planned for an FFA. But unfortunately, patient landed up into a stroke, and then he was thrombolyzed, and then the diagnosis was very clear. Probably a PHCR which bled in blood at the macula. Then we did a gas displacement, then we did surgery, tried to remove most of it, but yes, this is probably around 3 months. Then 6 months later, we removed the oil also. Did an FFA, ICG, wide field ICG, but no active lesions, because PHCRs are known to cause this bleed, and yes, there are high-risk characteristics like this thrombolysis, or patients who have some spontaneous hemorrhages, on patients who are on blood thinners, either aspirin or clopidogrel, they can also have like this. And then the late ICG, this is around 6 months or a year later, which does not show any active disease in the periphery. So the take-home message from this case was that not all lesions are melanomas, so a clinical evaluation, looking for signs in each and every case, and having a multimodal imaging and trying to come to one specific conclusion is very important, and try to rule out other mimickers like subretinal hemorrhage, PHCR, or a peripheral large PED. MRI, we should not always take on a face value that if the radiologist is giving you an answer, it's probably a melanoma or retinoblastoma. We need to go and try to evaluate the films which are provided. So this was another interesting case, a 60-year-old female which just came to us for a glass prescription. I evaluated her, then I could see there is some kind of a mass lesion again in the right eye temporally, but which had some stippled hyperfluorescence over that lesion. Again, age a little, as probably sir was showing up, this can be a case of nevus, as we can see, there are different classifications which have been provided by Dr. Shields' group: flat, bumpy, large. But the most important part is having this drusenoid deposits over here. So just a simple OCT can give you an answer that probably whether this is a nevus or whether it is nevus which is converting into a melanoma. Again, as you can see, a little bumpy kind of an appearance over here. Again, a drusenoid deposit which is correlating to the drusen-like deposits in the retina. But the most important part, as Sir was also discussing, this chiotic or intraretinal fluid. So at that point of time, we were not sure whether this is an activity, because every time we have been taught any fluid near the nevus, it's an activity. But it's not always, it's not always. The fluid actually means a subretinal fluid. So if you are having a subretinal fluid, then the risk of having this conversion or transformation into a melanoma is very high. In an FFA, as you can see, there is a leakage in the peripheral part where the little fluid pockets are over here when the OCT, which we have done. And this fluid still persists after around a year also as we are following it up. This fluid is exactly the same over here. The type of the scan is different, so that's why. But otherwise, the subretinal fluid is more important. There are other signs in cases of nevus which we need to look for. Are this probably a blood vessel or cavitations, which I think the previous... I'm not sure. Probably this. So there are either cavitations or this small areas of blood vessels which we see within this nevus are again diagnostic of an OCT based imaging. Octaphor nevus is also being described where it shows signal void areas. This is a lot of artifacts, but some kind of this signal void area is seen in that. So the take home message is SRF is diagnostic or highly suspicious of melanoma. The drusen can have intraretinal fluid, schizis, or tumor vessels or cavitations, and the size is very important. This was a lady which was referred from Bangladesh, diagnosed as melanoma for further management. Probably this is a very clear-cut spotter that what it case may be, because it's having a jet black color pigment which is having a stuck-on kind of an appearance. And the OCT is showing that there is some kind of a material which is so dense that it is causing a complete back shadowing, like a cutout over there in the OCT. So the diagnosis is clear cut in this case. It's a congenital simple hamartoma of retinal pigment epithelium, which is diagnosed by a jet black colored pigmented lesion present over the lesion. And it can be associated with VMT or can have pigment migration in the adjacent areas, exudation, and rarely transformation. So this is again an interesting case. This was a 60-year-old female which came to us with decreased vision since 1 month. And we can see there are some reddish black colored lesion. And I'm not sure whether these are feeder vessels with cataract. And there was no view inside. And on MRI, again, it looks like probably some kind of a melanoma. And UBM is showing that the tumor is somewhere sitting in the past plicata. So we did an incisional biopsy at that point. It showed only melanin or melanin-laden pigment cells. This is 3 weeks later, where we can see that the pigmentation has increased. So whether this is a transformation, whether this is just a nevus, conjunctival nevus, which is happening like this. Then we did the vitrectomy, and we could see that it's still persistent. We again took a biopsy from this point. Actually, we can see that it's little increased again after probably, this is probably again 1 month after the vitrectomy and incisional, second incisional biopsy. So this showed that actually it's a melanocytoma. So this is a melanocytoma of ciliary body which presents very late. And yes, the important point is that it can have this migration. So it doesn't mean that it is transforming. So it can have a migration to see emissary vessels and come into the anterior chamber, come over into the iris and cause melanosis, increase pigmentation, astigmatism, cataract. Again, interesting case of optic nerve head melanocytoma. Every one of us would have seen. The same patient we had seen probably around 6 months or a year later, if I remember. So as you can see, there is some fuzziness around here, around the margin, and the size of the tumor has also increased. And probably 3 months later, again, as you can see from there, it has migrated into subretinal space. So is this a transformation? So OCT, if you can see, this is the area where the subretinal pigments are there. We did an incisional fine needle aspiration cytology, and it proved that it's not a malignant cell, but yes, some pigment-laden macrophages were there. Octa, again, probably Pradeep has many of publications on it, that to look for any blood vessels within the tumor. So if we see any blood vessels, then there are very high chances that this may be a melanoma or a transformation into a melanoma. So this is again follow-up after 6 months, so where we can see the pigment is still there, not further progressing. So optic nerve head melanocytomas are notorious to cause vein occlusions, arterial occlusions, optic neuritis, secondary optic neuritis, or pigment migration, and yes, rarely transformation where the biopsy may be helpful. Very interesting case. This was referred to us after 3 VR surgeries for recurrent endophthalmitis. 7-year-old guy. So as we can see, this is when we are doing an EUA, this is a light pipe, and we can see that there are some cells which are floating very freely into the vitreous cavity, and these are all white, small, fluffy lesions which are present on the iris and on all towards to the angle, and there is some kind of a hypopyon. So we did AC tab, which showed some round cells. We were not sure that what it is. On B scan, when we tried to see, there was one area which showed a small calcification. MRI, actually it was not reported anything, but when we looked in each and every film, we could identify that one film was showing this kind of a calcification. So this was a patient which was probably having a diffuse infiltrating retinoblastoma, which is very difficult because the calcification is very rare and very small areas which it may have. So this is after one injection of melphalan. As you can see, the lesion is very far periphery. And then we sent it for a re-evaluation in SN, and then it was confirmed that this is a retinoblastoma. After even third recurrence, then probably because of the recurrence and complicated, the cornea become hazy, then it was enucleated after that. So yes, difficult diagnosis, but yes, children presenting early age, unilateral white eye reflex, try to rule out retinoblastoma, do a UBM, MRI, B scan. Most importantly, it's a cumulative effort of clinical evaluation, and yes, we have to study each and every film of the MRI. This is the last case, very interesting case. A surgery was done probably around 3 years back for a pterygium excision, and this kind of presentation. This is obviously a tumor. I don't know why it is not. This is obviously, because as you can see over here, Rose Bengal stain is also positive. And UBM was actually showing that there is some kind of a connection between this lesion into the retina. But it showed out as hyalinized and calcific mass. So this is a spontaneous extrusion of a scleral plaque, which is common after surgeries, some kind of a scar. And it is not a malignant lesion, it's a benign lesion. Thank you.